beberapa kali.
Hello, good afternoon everybody.
Good afternoon, sir.
So, who will present in this session? Can you tell me the name
me,
of the student and the group?
Hey, group, sir.
Me, and yeah. Muhammad Ali Sekolah.
Yeah. Then?
Rifo Nantan, sir.
Habib, after them, yeah. Ini, sir. Yukonatan.
Yeah. And then after again?
Mine is the chapter, sir, I think.
Yeah, after again? So there are three group again, or two group? Yeah?
Only yeah, two group, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Before we start, yeah, please, you must ready for your opening remarks, please, Felicia.
Okay, so good afternoon, sir, and all my friends. It's nice that I can see you again in the second session. I hope that this session can give us more knowledge and good luck for the next presenters. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Mayang. Mayang,
okay, so hello, good afternoon, everyone. So we come back here again, and we will hear the presentation from our friends, which is Eric Parulian and Riskula and other. And hope you can deliver it well. Thank you.
Okay, Radina.
Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello, everyone, and Adi. And I just want to say good luck for the next presentation. And sorry, I think there's something wrong with my camera and I will fix it as soon as possible. Thank you.
Linda. Linda. Hello, Linda. Linda Larasati.
Okay, good afternoon, Sir Adi and friends. It's good to see you again in second section. I hope our study run well. Good luck for the presenter, Muhammad Rizkullah, Eric Parulian Tanjaya, and Rifonatan Gael. Stay healthy and have a nice day. Thank you.
Alda Dwi Putri.
Good afternoon, Sir Adi and friends. Good luck for today's presentation. Thank you.
Reka Dwi Putri, Reka Wati Dwi Putri, Reka Wati ya, Reka Wati, Reka Wati, what's your name?
Reka Wati Ratu Loli Putri.
Oh ya, yeah. Reka Wati please.
Oke, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, Sir Adi friends. Nice to see you again in second section, and good luck for the presenters today. Thank you.
Rigo.
Good afternoon, guys. Okay, nice to meet you again in the second session. I hope we can still enjoy the class. Good luck for the presenter. Where is my face? Where is
my face?
Where is my face?
Where is my face? Where is my face? Bella Safira? Bella Safira.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir and friend. So this is our second session for today class. I hope all of the presenter can present the material well, and of course I'm ready for today class for session 2. Thank you.
Bella Nurkomara.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's nice to see you again in the second session. I would like to say good luck for the presenter.
Okay,
Eggy. Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to see you again, and I hope the second session will be running well. Thank you.
Bobby Wijaya.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. So great to see you all of you again in this second section for today. Good luck to those who represent today, Eggy, Noval, and Pete. Thank you.
Okay,
Noval. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope our presentation today will be run well, and all of us can get the benefit from it. Thank you.
Eric Parulian.
Good afternoon, Sir Adi and my friend. It's nice to see you again after a long break. So good luck for the presenter for the second section. Thank you.
Okay, play lagi ya. Lagi ya. Oke, Dinda.
Hello everyone, good afternoon. It's great to see everyone again on the second session. I wish the best of luck for the second session presenter, and I hope that we can learn so much about HRM today. Thank you.
Vi Francisca. Vi Francisca.
Yeah, good afternoon everyone. I hope we are stay healthy and good luck for the presenter today. Thank you.
Karin, Claudia.
Good afternoon, Sir Adi and all of my friends. I would like to say welcome back again for the second session and hope that the presenter can present the material very well, and also hope that we can understand about the material. And stay safe, everyone.
Para Romita.
Good afternoon, sir and friends. It's good to see all of you again. And good luck for the group who will present today. Thank you.
Apa lagi ya?
Masih loading, sir, mau masuk.
Oh ya, okay, please. Escola, please, it is your time to present your topic, please. Escola, no problem, please.
Okay, sir.
Escola, ya, Escola.
May I get the host, sir?
Eric will present the screen, sir.
Escola, wait a moment. Make a host, okay. Escola, I have made Escola a host.
I think you can make Eric as a host, sir, because Eric will present the screen.
Okay, Escola, you can make Eric a host, please, Eric.
Okay, sir.
Okay, Escola, must make Eric as a host, please.
Yes, sir.
Can you see the slide, everyone?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I will start it. So good morning, Sir Adi and everyone. Now I'm Eric Pauriantanja and my friend Mom Ariskula Naval will deliver our material about risk management and worker protection. So in our material, there are several points for discussion that is about the main point that relate with our material. The first one is A, global health, safety, and security. B, worker compensation. C, organizational commitment and a safety culture. D, safety policies, discipline, and record keeping. F, security management. G, employee screening and selection. And H, disaster planning for disease. Next, I will give it to Nopal.
Okay, let's talk about the risk management. So risk management is the process of assessing the risk to the safety and health of employees due to hazards in the workplace. Risk management is the first step in the process of managing risk, which allows people to understand, identify employers and employees. What are the measures to be taken to improve safety and health in the workplace? Large organizations mostly have formed a committee, team or department risk management to take care of the process of risk management. Nevertheless, during the risk management process, every employee in the organization is obligated to play its part in all the stages. For instance, for example, like compliance with policies and procedures, risk identification and report to complete. Next. The first emphasis in HR risk management in most organizations is health, safety, and security. The terms health, safety, and security are closely related. The broader and somewhat more nebulous term is health, which refers to a general state of physical, mental, and emotional well-being. A health person is free from illness, injury, or mental and emotional problems that impair normal human activity. Health management practices and organizations strive to maintain employees' overall well-being. Next. So the first point is global health, safety, and security. Safety and health laws and regulation vary from country to country, ranging from virtual non-existence to more stringent and than those in United States. The importance placed on health, safety, and security relates somewhat to the level of regulation and other factors in each country. Next. And then this is the worker compensation. So first passed in the early 90s, workers' compensation laws in some form are on the books in all states today. Under these laws, employers contribute to an insurance fund to compensate employers from injuries received while on the job. Premiums paid reflect the accident rates of the employers, with employers that have higher incident rates being assessed higher premiums. This law usually provide payments to replace wages for injuries workers depending on the amount of lost time and the wage level.
Wait a minute, guys. Nopal is out of room. Let's disconnect.
Okay, next week. Next. No, before, yes, this is. So this is the organizational commitment and safety culture. Well-designed and well-managed safety programs can pay dividends in reduced accidents and associated costs, such as worker compensation and possible fines. At the heart of safety management is an organizational commitment to comprehensive safety effort that should be coordinated at the top level of management and include all members of the organization. It also should be reflected in managerial action. A president of a small electrical manufacturing firm who does not wear a hard hat in the manufacturing shop can hardly expect to enforce requirement that all employers wear hats in the shop. And then the safety engineering employers can prevent some accident by designing machines, equipment, and work areas so that the workers who perform potential dangerous jobs cannot injure themselves and others. And then next. Next week. And then this is the safety policies, discipline, and record keeping. So designing safety policies, designing safety policies and rules and discipline, violators are important components of safety efforts, frequently reinforcing the need for safe behavior. And frequently supplying feedback on positive safety practices are also effective ways of improving worker safety. Such as safety conscious effort must involve employees, supervisors, managers, safety specialists, and HR staff members. And for the policies about safety to be effective, good work keeping about accident, cause, and other details is necessary. Without records, an employer cannot track its safety performance, compare benchmark against other employers, and may not realize the extent of its safety problems. And the next slide will be delivered by Eric.
So I will continue. A, emotional or mental health. Many individuals are family and personal life pressure. Although most people manage this pressure successfully, some individuals have difficulty handling the demands. Specific events such as death, a spouse, divorce, a medical problem can affect individuals who otherwise have been coping successfully with life pressure. A variety of emotional or mental health issues arise at work that must be addressed by employers. Employees' concern about maintaining a healthy workforce must move beyond simply providing healthy working conditions and begin promoting employee health and wellness in other ways. Mental health promotion is a supportive approach of facilitating and encouraging healthy action and lifestyle among employees. Health promotion effort can range from providing information and increasing employee awareness of health issues to creating an organizational culture supportive of employee health enhancement. Then, F, security management. A comprehensive approach to security management is needed to address a wide range of issues, including a workplace violence. HR manager may have responsibility for security program or may work closely with the security manager or consultant. In a security audit, HR conduct a comprehensive review of organizational security, sometimes called a vulnerability analysis, such as an audit use manager inside and outside the organization. Control access is a key part of security, involves controlling access to the physical facilities of the organization. And G, employee screening and selection. A key phase of providing security is screening job applicants. HR manager is somewhat limited by the legal constraint on what can be done. Particularly regarding the use of psychological tests and checking of reference. However, firms that do not screen employee adequately may be subject to a liability if an employee commit crimes later. For instance, an individual with a criminal record for assault was hired by a firm to maintain some equipment in clients' homes. The employee used a passkey to enter a home and assaulted the owner. Consequently, the employee was ruled liable for not doing an adequate background check. And then H, disaster planning for disease. The concern about flu and other pandemic diseases have led OSHA to establish guidelines for employees to use. The guidelines have a special section for firms in the poultry production industry due to their higher vulnerability. Relatively, U.S. employers and other worldwide organizations are prepared for the spread of pandemic flu or any other critical environment disease. The recommendation for preparation are similar to other types of disease planning, but specialized policies, programming, and training may be needed. Expert project that there could be a major epidemic disease spread, whether a natural one or one instigated by terrorism. Thus, risk management prepare for this specialized area is part of broader disease preparation and recovery planning efforts. Then this is for the question of the critical thinking. So the first question is, how does one go about controlling workers' compensation costs and why is it important? And number two, how do you identify risk management in the workplace? And three, how can you minimize the risk in the workplace? So for the student who want to answer, you can unmute your mic. Hello. Anyone want to answer?
May I answer the third question?
Sorry.
Hello. May I answer the third question?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
So about how to minimize the risk in the workplace. I think the first, if it is possible, we should always take the option of a less risky alternative in order to conduct the job. And then also, if it is possible, we should set up our workplace and particular section in the workplace to ensure there is reduced exposure to any risk which have been identified. And then ensure that we do not come into contact with a risk which has already been identified. And if our workplace requires personal protective equipment, then ensure that we wear these equipment whenever we are in the workplace. And the last, also ensure that we personally know where to go if we need to find some first aid or washing products to help if an incident has occurred in which we need to clean or cut or our bandage or one or wound. I think that's my answer.
Okay, Ruby, thank you. That you mean we have to follow the protocol that have already made by the company or the organization.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ruby. Anyone want to answer?
Maybe the other. The other student.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello.
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 Yeah, can I answer number two?
Yes, please. Okay.
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Yes. Okay. So the question is, how do you identify my voice? Hello,
yes, yes.
Can you hear my voice?
Yes.
Okay, so there are ways to identify risk in the organization. First is break down the big picture. Risk is multifaceted. There are many categories: competitive, financial, safety, operational, technological, legal, political, reputational, and so on. So break down your organization into each of these areas and consider the individual weaknesses of each department. The second one is be pessimistic. At this stage, it is important to avoid overconfidence and thinking something like can't or won't happen. Challenge all of your assumptions about potential risks and be prepared for any or all of them to occur. The third one is consult an expert. And the fourth one is conduct internal research. The fifth one is to conduct external research. Here, you can also pay attention to your competitors or companies similar to yours, analysis, risk management successes, news releases, or even legal precedents can help you identify the same types of risks in the organization. And the sixth one is to seek employee feedback regularly. The seventh one is analyze customer complaints. And the last one is to use models or software. So here there are many business and technological strategies that help identify and classify risks, like simulation, scenario role-playing, SWOT analysis, flowcharts, and risk mapping are just some of them. I think that's all my answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Felice, for the point that you have tell to us how to identify the management in the workplace. Thank you, Felice.
Thank you.
Anyone want to answer number one? Someone?
I think if there is no one to answer number one, we can next to the next slide, Eric.
Okay. So we will talk about the study case. And you can read this one, or maybe you want to take the screenshot. All right. have you guys read the study case? So I will move to the question of study case. Question number one, how would you communicate a data security policy that requires software checking of employees' emails? And number two, what elements should a data security policy for a bank include? And third question, employee data that most frequently occurs with new employees or when an employee has given notice and is leaving, how would you deal with these two part very different issues? So anyone who want to answer, you can unmute your mic and answer it.
Hello, Eric. May I try to answer number one?
Yes, yeah, you can, Paradina.
Oh, okay, thank you. But I will ask a minute for thinking the answer.
Okay.
Hello, Eric. So I will try to answer number one.
Yes, yes, you can feel it.
Okay, if I was put in the chart of communicating a data security policy that requires software checking of employees' emails, the first thing I would do would be to make sure I fully understand the policy myself. I would be unable to effectively communicate the new policy to the employees if I didn't fully understand it myself. If I had any questions about the policy, I would speak to the human resources professional in charge of the policy for clarification. Once I had a full understanding of the policy, I would set up employee meetings by department. I would begin each meeting by discussing risk management. I would explain that risk management involves responsibilities to consider physical, human, and financial factors to protect organizational and individual interests, and that the goal is to not only protect company information, but also employee information. Once I ensured that the employees understood risk management, I would then introduce the data security itself that utilizes software checking of employees' email. And I would describe the policy completely and inform the employees that the policy is being put in place to prevent both company and personal data from being stolen or leaked. I would then open the floor to any questions that employees had on the new policy. Once all the questions had been answered, I would pass out a form for all the employees to sign and that stating that they understood the policy and gave their consent to the company. To ensure that the future employee meetings to discuss the policy are not required, I will add the policy to all future employment's contract. So that's all my questions. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you for answering our question. And whoever want to answer number two and number three?
Can I try answer number two?
Yes, Farah Aramika, you can.
Data security is a set of policy issued by an organization to ensure that all information technology user within the domain on the organization or its network comply with rules and guidelines related to the security of the information stored digitally at any point in the network or within the organization boundaries of authority. Understanding that the data security policy is in fact not just one policy, but a set of policy, means that different policies can be written for the various area of risk management. For instance, one policy should be written to allow the data security program to determine the vulnerabilities in the bank internal and external software. Another security policy should be created to deal with the vulnerabilities found in the bank's internal security, and another for the bank's external security. A separate policy should be written to help reduce data security problems that come with human error. This policy will involve training the bank's employee in computer security. The data security program should also include a data recovery program or data backup that allows the bank to recover information or have access to
Halo, Kak Romka.
Okay, that's the answer.
Ah, I see. Thank you, Farah, to answer our question. So, who want to answer the last question, number three. Anyone? Okay, if there is no one want to answer, I think I will move to the next slide. So we will arrive to the Q&A section. For those three people who want to ask our question, you can ask.
Hello, Eric. Eric. I wanna ask Eric.
Okay, Egi.
Okay. Just ask. So my question is, can you give example of the case that contains wait a second. Can you give the example of risk management? Thank you.
Okay. Okay, the next question. Maybe the others want to ask.
Hello, Naval and Eric.
Okay, like
I want to ask. Okay, can you hear my voice?
Of course.
Okay. My question is, can you mention about the step of risk management process? Thank you.
Okay, welcome. And then the last question, maybe.
Hello, Nopal and PT. Hello.
Okay, Robby. Hello.
So I would like to ask, how does the workplace safety affect the efficiency? Thank you.
Okay, Robby, thank you for your question. Okay, I think we need to discuss the question first.
So I will answer the Rivo Nathangael question first. That is about what is the example of risk management. So the example of risk management is, first one is when a bank employee review a potential loan to determine what the chance are that the buyer won't pay it back. And in order to decide how to proceed with granting to the loan and how much the charge interest. And then in the second example is when a person evaluates the chance of having major bad bills and decided whether to purchase pet insurance. Okay, you got it, Egi?
Okay, Eric, I got it. Thank you.
Thank you, Egi.
So, okay, I will answer the question from Robby, and the question is how does workplace safety affect the efficiency? So, as we know that the safety culture of workplace is developed in facility, employee productivity significantly increased, and factory costs noticeably decreased. From the study found that the focusing on reducing errors that led to accidents led to implementing training, auditing, and safety measures can reduce the expense. So when the safeguards are put into place and workers feel safe doing their job, employees are more likely to take personal accountability and be engaged in their work. So it has been proven there is a link between workers' happiness at work and their productivity. Engaged employees are more likely to be safe at work and more likely to work efficiently. Not only that, but also a safe and healthy workplace will protect workers from injury and illness. It can also lower injury or illness costs. In the other words, safety is good for business. And then for the last question, from Leka, the question is, can you mention about the steps of risk management process? So basically there are 5 steps of risk management process. The first step is to identify the risks that the business is exposed to in its operating environment. So there are many different types of risks, for example, like legal risk, environmental risk, and market risk. So it is important to identify as many of these risks factor are possible. In a manual environment, these risks are noted down manually. And then the second step is analyze the risk. So once a risk has been identified, it needs to be analyzed. The scope of the risk must be determined. It is also important to understand the link between the risk and different factors within the organizations. To determine the severity and seriousness of the risk, it is necessary to see how many business function the risk affects. And then for the step, the third step is risk need to be ranked and prioritized. So most risk management solution have different categories of risk depending on the severity of the risk. A risk that may cause some inconvenience is rated lowly, and then the risk that can result in a big problems are rated the highest. And then the fourth step is treat the risk. Every risk need to be eliminated or contained as much as possible. This is done by connecting with the expert of the field to which the risk belong to. In a manual environment, this entails contacting each and every stakeholder and then setting up meetings so everyone can talk and discuss about the issue that may be happen in the company. And then the last step is monitoring and review the risk. So as we know that not all risks can be eliminated. Some risks are always present. For example, like market risk and environmental risk are just to the example of risks that always need to be monitored. So under the manual system monitoring happens, through diligence employees, this professional must make sure that they keep a close watch on all the risk factors so they can monitor and review the risk. I think that's all about the answer for Leka question. Is it clear, Leka?
Okay, thank you, Naufal.
Okay, you're welcome. I think that's all about our presentation today, and I'm sorry if there is a mistake that I make. And thank you for your attention, guys. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Thank you, guys.
Okay. Enough. Okay, I think it is good. Yeah, good presentation. So I think it is clear. So risk management is very important. Yeah. So when we talk about risk, we talk about insurance, right? Yeah. When we talk about risk, we talk about insurance. So risk management is a subject in university. So before, I don't know. Do you study risk management in campus? At campus? Do you study risk management? Do you study risk management?
I'm not see the course of risk management, sir.
Yeah. So when we talk about risk management, it is like insurance management. Yeah. So all the companies must the employees to get insurance, right? So there are many kind of risks happening to the employees at work, like health, and then injury, etc. So yeah. So risk must be managed very, very well. So if there is it's not made very well, so it will also damage the company, so right? The company cannot get good result if the employee is not insured. Yeah. So all of the people, all the employees must be insured. And then the money or the fee must be deducted from the salary, so right? So like you work in a company and you work before the computer. So what risk will you get if you work before the computer from the morning to the evening? So you look at the computer. So what happened? What will you get? What kind of risk will you get?
Back injury, sir.
Yeah.
Back injury.
What kind of injury?
Back injury.
Yeah, like maybe your eye. There is something wrong with your eyes, right?
Because yes.
You look at the screen, and then when your eyes, when there's something wrong with that, so you must go to the hospital, right? So in this case, the company must work together with the insurance company and the BBGS, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
But when the employer is hospitalized, so the cost must be assumed by the insurance, right? But the employer must pay the premium, right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think this place is good. Yeah, it is understandable. Is it the last presenter? Who is the last presenter?
Maybe, yeah. Sir.
Only one person?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What's the topic?
Management relation, sir.
Oh yeah, yeah. Okay, please, Sergi. This is your turn. Okay. To present your topic.
Okay. Noval, can you make me as a host? Okay, thank you. Can you see the screen?
Yes, Egi.
Okay. So, good afternoon, sir and my friends. So today I will present a short presentation about union or management relation. Okay, first, work-related alternative dispute, or we can call it dispute resolution or ADR. Disputes between management and employees over different work issues are normal and inevitable, but how the parties resolve the disputes can become important. Formal grievance procedures and lawsuits provide two resolution methods. However, more and more companies are looking to alternative means of ensuring that due process occurs in case involving employees' rights. Dissatisfaction with the expense and delays that are common in the court system when lawsuits are filed explain the growth in alternative dispute resolution or ADR methods such as arbitration, peer review panels, and ombuds. So we will start from arbitration first. Arbitration is a process that uses a neutral third party to make a decision, thereby eliminating the necessity of using the court system. Arbitration has been a common feature in union contracts. However, it must be set up carefully if employers want to use it in non-union situation, because employers often select the arbitrators, and because arbitrators may not be required to issue written decisions and opinions. Many see this use of arbitration in employment-related situation as unfair. Some firms use compulsory arbitration, which require employees to sign a pre-employment agreement stating that all disputes will be submitted to arbitration and that employees waive their right to pursue legal action until the completion of the arbitration process. And next is the peer review panels. So employers allow the employees to appeal disciplinary action to an internal committee or employees. This panel review the action and makes recommendation or decision. Peer review panels use fellow employees and a few managers to resolve employment disputes. Panel members are specially trained volunteers who sign confidentiality agreements, after which the company empowers them to hear appeals. These panels have several advantages, including favor lawsuit, provision of due process, lower costs, and management, and also employee development. Next, it's ombuds. Some organizations ensure process and fairness through ombuds, individuals outside the normal chain of command who act as independent problem solver for both management and employees. At a number of large and medium-sized firms, ombuds have effectively addressed complaints about unfair treatment, employee or supervisor conflicts, and other workplace behavior issues. Ombuds address employees' complaints and operate with a high degree of confidentiality. Any follow-up to resolve problem is often handled informally, except when a situation includes unusual or significant illegal action. Next, we will talk about managing individual employee and employee rights issues. Balancing both employees and employees' rights is a growing HR concern due to more legal and court case and expanding global workforce. Employers have legitimate rights and needs to ensure that employees are doing their jobs and working in a secure environment. While employees expect their right both at work and away from home to be protected. The dramatic increase in internet communication, Twitter, specialized computers, and telecommunication system is transforming many workplaces. That is why having an HR culture that incorporates privacy as a key component is important. The use of technology items by employees to monitor employee action is amplifying concern that the privacy rights of employee are being threatened. Next is privacy rights and employee records. So there is some records that the company need for their employee. First is employee medical records. As interpreted by attorney and HR practitioner, this provision requires that all medical related information be maintained separately from all other confidential files. The Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act also contains regulation designed to protect the privacy of employee medical records. Second is security of employee record. It is important that specific access restriction and security procedures for employee records be established. This restriction and procedures are designed to protect the privacy of employee and to protect employers from potential liability for improper disclosure of personal information. A legal regulation called the Data Protection Act requires employers to keep personal records up to date and to keep only the details that are needed. The last is the electronic records. An increasing concern is how electronic records are maintained and secured, given the change in software, email, and other technology means. Estimates are there that more than 200 billion community emails are sent daily. Many of these emails may relate to some aspect of electronic records and record action. Therefore, employers should be establish electronic record policies to ensure legal compliance and to avoid violating individuals' personal rights. And next, we will talk about employees' free speech rights. There are three areas in which employee freedom of speech has collided with employers' restriction. There are employee advocacy of controversial views, whistleblowing, and use of the internet and other technology. Sorry, because of time, I cannot explain you more details about these three. So maybe you can read it individually in the book. So next, we will talk about technology and employer or employee issues. The extensive growth of technology used by employers and employees is constantly creating new issues to be addressed. Such technology usage of Twitter, wikis, social networking, and blogs require attention by employers. For instance, ethical issues surrounding blogs and how they can lead to termination are highlighted in the HR online. This includes monitoring electronic communication and HR-made policies on electronic communication. Next is HR policies, procedure, and rules. HR policies, procedure, and rules greatly affect employee rights, where there is a choice among action. Policies act as general guidelines that help focus the organizational action. Procedures provide customary methods of handling activities and are more specific than policies. For example, a policy may state that employees will be given vacations according to years of service, and a procedure establishes a specific method for authorizing vacation time without disrupting work. Rules are specific guidelines that regulate and restrict the behavior of individuals. They are similar to procedures in that they grant action to and typically allow no discretion in their application. Rules reflect a management decision that action be taken or not taken in a given situation, and they provide more specific behavioral guidelines than do policies. An example of a rule might be that a vacation day may not be scheduled the day before or after a holiday. Next is about employee absenteeism. Absenteeism is any failure by an employee to report for work as scheduled or to stay at work when scheduled. There are some types of absenteeism. Clearly, some absenteeism is inevitable because of illness, death in the family, and other personal reasons. So, absence such as those that are health related are unavoidable and understandable. They can be very costly. And next, we will see how to control absenteeism. First is disciplinary approach. Many employers use this sports approach. People who are absent the first time receiving an oral warning and subsequent absence bring written warnings, suspension, and finally dismissal. Second is positive reinforcement. Positive reinforcement includes such action as giving employees cash, recognition, time off and other rewards for meeting attendance standards. And third is combination approach. A combination approach ideally rewards desired behaviors and punish undesired behavior. This carrot and stick approach use policies and discipline to punish offenders, evaluate programs and rewards to recognize employees with outstanding attendance. Fourth is no-fault policy. With a no-fault policy, the reason for absence do not matter, and the employees must manage their own attendance unless they abuse that freedom. Once absenteeism exceeds normal limits, the disciplinary action up to and including termination of employment can occur. And the last is paid time off or PTO programs. Some employers have paid time off programs in which vacation time, holidays, and sick leave for each employee are combined into a PTO account. Employees use days from their accounts at their discretion for illness, personal time, or vacation. If employees run out of days in their accounts, they are not paid for any additional days missed. And next, we will talk about employee discipline. Discipline is a form of training that enforce organizational rules. Those most often affected by the discipline system are problem employees. Fortunately, problem employees comprise a small number of employees. If employees fail to deal with problem employees, negative effects for employees and group often result. Common disciplinary issues caused by problem and employees include absenteeism, tardiness, productivity deficiencies, alcoholism, and insubordination. And next, we will see how to approach the discipline. First is counseling. The goal of this phase is to heighten employee awareness of organizational policies and rules. Often, people simply need to be made aware of rules and knowledge of possible disciplinary action may prevent violation. And second is threaten documentation. If an employee fails to correct behavior, then a second conference becomes necessary, whereas the first takes place as a confrontation between supervisor and the employee. This stage is documented in written form, and written solutions are identified to prevent further problems from occurring. Third is final warning. If the employee does not follow the written solutions, not in the second step, a final warning of a conference is held. In that conference, the supervisor emphasizes to the employee and the importance of correcting the inappropriate action. And the last is discharge. If the employee fails to follow the action plan that was developed and for the problem exists, then the supervisor can discharge the employee. Okay, now we will go to the case study. I take a case study from one of the company and on America called MTA. A state-operated mass carrier organization, the Maryland Transit Administration, or MTA, operates a comprehensive system of bus, light rail, metro subway, and MARTH train to the Baltimore-Washington metro area. MTA is also responsible for planning resource and funding for Maryland's freight rail system and locally operate transit system, or LOTS, manages the taxi access system, and operates a complete paratransit or mobility system. MTA approached LaborSoft, one of a company, to assist with inadequate case management and provide a labor relation system that could accommodate their complex organizational structure. The fact of any identified system that will provide collaborative data and grievance and HR events. MTA relied on manual entry spreadsheets and this and siloed database to host carriers related operation and documentation. This caused in anomalies and processing delays culminating in undesirable outcomes. The MTA's limited capacity in handling other departments' grievance process was a detriment to the organization. So the question is, what do you think the solution that can be given by LaborSoft to MTA problem? If you want to answer, you can open the mic. Anyone want to answer?
Hello, Iggy.
Hello, Felicia.
Yes, parents answer.
Yeah, yes, please.
So maybe together, LabourSoft and MTA conducted an evaluation of the internal working of their employee relations processes. So the result was the development of an HR case management system that was configured to meet MTA's discipline, arbitration, and grievance or dispute resolution requirements. So the solution improved collaboration among the HR professionals and department managers. MTA used LabourSoft centralized cloud-based documentation to easily share information with the HR team members. So documentation could easily be gathered for meetings, management reports, and legal professionals if necessary. So having case data centralized also help the MTA improve HR consistently. Here HR policies are loaded into the system for a quick reference, and cases can be quickly referenced to ensure they are be resolved consistently. I think that's all my answer. Thank you, Aggie.
Okay, thank you, Felicia, for your answer. Okay, next we will move to the question session. Number one, in your opinion, is monitoring the employees affect the performance of the company itself? And second, do you think the usage of technology in a company is important in HR context? Why? And the third is why procedures and rules are very important for a company? Anyone want to answer?
Hello, Aggie. Can I try to answer number three?
Yes, Felicia, please.
Okay, so the question is procedures and why procedures and rules are very important for a company. So in my opinion, procedures and rules are very important for a company as they serve several benefits like protecting the employees. So by protecting employees, we protect the company from lawsuits. Following rules and procedures help employees to understand what is expected from them and what will happen if they violate the rules. It makes for a stable office environment where people feel to go business, less turnover and teamwork, and then higher company morale. So by having everyone follow properly communicated rules and procedures, it is like, so the company will make more money, and when employees follow rules and procedures, consumers also benefit and are protected. I think that's
okay. Thank you, Felicia, for your answer.
Hello.
Yes, Celine first.
Can I answer number two?
Okay, you can.
Okay, so the question is, do you think the usage of a technology in a company is important in HR context? So I think the usage of technology in a company is really important, especially for HR context, because as we know that when HR a manager, for example, like want to recruiting the people or recruiting the other people to work in a company, they need to know the data of their new employees. So I think using this technology, the HR manager can know, for example, like the background of the person, and then know the data of him or herself, for example, like the name, the ability, and others. And also the usage of technology in a company is also really important for HR context, because for example, like HR manager that want to hire some people outside of the company, they can share the things or the, for example, account of the CP or other thing, they can do it by on email. So I think that's really important to use the technology for HR context. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shailene. That's a good answer. Next, anyone want to answer number one?
May I try to answer number one?
Okay, go on, Dita.
Wait a minute. Mentoring offers numerous benefits to both for the mentor or the workers. It serves to broaden staff's insight into the business and build stronger relationship. Mentoring contributes to the success of the worker by improving performance, increasing confidence, and addressing strengths and weakness. A mentorship can help the worker learn and develop faster by encouraging an exchange of information that doesn't always exist naturally. Mentoring programs let employees know that the company values them and has an interest in their personal development, leading to increased productivity and also reduction turnover. By mentoring also benefit to the mentors itself by providing a sense of responsibility and a feeling of ownership in the company. It allows people who may not be a manager or supervisor to take on a leadership role. That's all my answer. Thank you.
Okay, Dita, thank you for your answer. That's a good answer. Okay, that's all from me. Now I will open three questions for you. Who's want to ask?
Hello, Egi.
Hello, Egi.
Okay, I think Della first. Della?
May I, Egi?
According to your opinion.
Okay. Sorry, Della, can you repeat? Because I don't hear it clearly.
So the question is, why HR policies, procedures, and rules are important according to your opinion?
Okay. Thank you. Next is Noval.
Okay, can you give the example of arbitration case in the company, and how does the company solve it? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Noval. Last question.
Okay, Noval. Noval, sorry.
Okay, Leka, go on.
My question is, why employers' right and employee right should be balanced? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Leka. Give me some minutes to answer the question. Okay, I think I will answer Leka question first. So the question is, why employer employee rights should be balanced? Because if it failing to take the necessary steps to ensure safety may result in employees being held criminally liable for safety violations. It is therefore imperative that a balance is maintained between the safety goals of employers and the human rights of employees than when dealing with substance abuse issues at the workplace. Is it clear, Leka?
Okay, Egi, I get it.
Okay.
Thank you for the answer.
Okay. Next, I will answer Noval question. Example of the arbitration case and how the company solved it. So I take one example of international arbitration case. A North American software developer had registered a trademark for communication software in a in the United States and Canada. A manufacturer of computer hardware based elsewhere registered an almost identical mark for computer hardware in a number of Asian countries. Both parties had been engaged in legal proceedings in various jurisdictions concerning the registration and use of their marks. Each party had effectively prevented the other from registering or using its mark in the jurisdiction in which it held for prior strikes. In order to facilitate the use and registration of their respective marks worldwide, the parties entered into a coexistence agreement which contains a waived IPO arbitration clause. When then North American company tried to register its marks in a particular Asian country, the application was refused because of a risk of confusion with a prior mark held by the other party. The North American company requests that the other party undertake any efforts to enable it to register its mark in that Asian country and when the other party refuses, initiates arbitration proceedings. Following proposals made by the center, the parties appoint a leading IP lawyer as sole arbitrator. In an interim award, the sole arbitrator gives effect to the consensual solution suggested by the parties, which provide for the granting by the hardware manufacturer of a license on appropriate terms to the North American company, including an obligation to provide periodic reports to the other party. Is it clear, Naval?
Yes, Egi. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, last is the last question, why HR policies and procedures are important. So, human resource policies and procedures are important because as they provide structure, control, consistency, fairness, and reasonableness in SMEs, they also ensure compliance with employment legislation and inform employees of their responsibility and their company's expectation. Is it clear for you, Dela?
Okay, thank you for your answer.
Okay, so that's all from me for today. I hope you can understand what I give to you, and thank you.
Okay, so you have watched your Egi presentation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. So you present by yourself the topic. So you have not answered it. So the last person or the student to present the topic, and the topic is under the industrial relations. So I think you have studied industrial relations, yeah, in this semester, right? Do you study industrial relations in this semester? More industry,
yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So,
yes.
Yes. It's under the subject, right? So you can ask the subject with your lecturer. Yeah, I think my task of teaching you is has been completed. Yeah, all of you have done your jobs very well. All of you have presented your topic very very well. And after the midterm test, you will be taught by Ibu Yulianti. Yeah. And then the time returns to 10 o'clock every Monday, so right? Yeah, so you will be taught by Ibu Yanti every Monday at 10 o'clock, so right? Not 12:30. So you come to the class at 10 o'clock. Maybe Google Classroom. Maybe Ibu Yanti will use Google Classroom. It's different from me, so right? I use Zoom. Maybe Ibu Yanti will have different way of teaching. Maybe she will use Google Classroom only, or maybe Google Meet, I don't know, so right? But yeah, at 10 o'clock the time, okay? I hope and hope that what I have given you is beneficial to you, and you can apply them in your life and when you work someday at work, okay? Before I end this program, this course, I thank you very much for your attention. So you have paid attention to this course very well, and before that you must give the closing remark, and you must say the impression and what you have got studying HRM for 7 meetings and what benefit can you get. Please, from Felicia, please. Felicia.
Okay, so first of all, okay, sir, can you hear my voice, sir? Yes. Hello, sir.
I can hear you, yes. I can hear you.
Okay.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to say thank you so much, Sir Adi, for all of this time as our lecturer of Advanced HRM, and I'm sorry if I made mistake all this time, sir. And I also would like to say thank you for all group presented materials for us today, and also the last meeting. I think all of you have done a really great presentation, and I also would like to say thank you for the opportunity for my group to present today as well. I hope you all can get the gist of our presentation about managing employee benefits. And also, I got many knowledge about Advanced HRM all this time, and for the lessons I got today and will benefit me in the future are about training human resource, and then talent management, risk management, and also worker protection and union management relation. I hope we all can pass the midterm exam very well. And thank you very much. Always stay healthy and have a good day, everyone.
Okay, Ridho, please, Ridho. Ridho.
Okay, so good afternoon all. I hope what we get from today can give us so many benefit. And thank you guys. See you next time in the next season.
Mayang, please. Mayang.
Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Okay. So I want to say thank you so much. For Mr. Adi that already given the suggestion for our presentation, and I wanna say thank you for my friends that already delivered about the material well, and I hope we together can learn about the material and understand about it, and we can prepare it for our mid semester, and we can get a good score and stay healthy and stay healthy. Thank you.
Pradina, please. Pradina. Pradina. Where are you? Pradina. Where is Pradina? Don't come. This important moment, you don't come. You don't. You are not here.
I think Farah's connection is
Okay, Dinda Pipa. Okay. Dinda Pipa.
Okay, thank you, sir. I would like to say thank you to everyone in the class for participating and presenting a very, very good material. I learned a lot lessons about advanced human resources, and I hope we all can stay healthy during these hard trying times. And I would like to say thank you to Sir Adi for teaching us for this half semester, and for the rest of this presenter that also teach me for through their presentation. I hope we all can pass the midterm exam excellent. Thank you.
Dita Larasati, please.
Yeah, thank you, Sir Adi, for teaching us until midterm. Thank you for all of my friends for the presentations. Thank you for pay attention to us, to me and Ridho today. For the lesson today, we can know more about what is training, talent management, and many knowledge about Advanced HRM. I hope what me and friends deliver today will get benefit for us. Stay healthy, have a nice day. I hope we can get a good score. See you next time.
Okay, Alda Dwi Putri.
Thank you to Mr. Adi for teaching us and today's presenters. The presentation was very good. I hope the knowledge can be useful for all of us in the future, and stay healthy. Thank you.
Nekawati.
Okay, first, thank you for Sir Adi for teaching us, and thank you for you guys give the good materials. I hope we always stay healthy and stay safe, guys. See you. Thank you.
Hey, Francisca.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for the presenter today. Thank you for Mr. Adil Salim for teaching us. I hope we are stay healthy. Thank you.
Egi. Egi.
Okay, good afternoon, sir and my friends. So thank you for Mr. Adi for teaching us this for today. And I hope all the materials I present can be used in our life sometimes. One time. Thank you.
Bella Safira. Bella Safira. Della? Please, Della.
Okay, first of all, I would like to say thank you for Mr. Adi and today's presenters. Thank you so much for delivering every material clearly and complete. And I hope those material could help me understand more about advanced human resource management. Thank you.
Okay. Vijaya.
So, hello everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for today, especially Mr. Adi, that for this two session for today, we have got so many presentations about the talent management, about planning, training, and the others. And I hope we can pass the midterm examination with a good marks. And once again, thank you.
Okay. Eric Carolian. Celine Claudia, please, Celine.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for Saradi for teaching us for this half semester. Hope that everything that we have learned before, we can understand and we can implement it to our daily life or in the future when we are becoming a manager. And also, thank you for all of my friends that have been presented the materials. I really understand well because of your presentation. And I just hope that we have a good score for our midterm. And stay safe, everyone. Thank you.
Para Romika, please. Para Romika.
Good afternoon. I want to say thank you very much to Saradi and everyone who already present, who already explained the material very well. Thank you.
Let's go, law. Let's go, law.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to say thank you to Mr. Adi that about the material that you give to us. And then for the all of the presenter that has presented the material, I hope we can get the benefit and we can apply it in the future about the benefit.
Okay.
So thank you. Stay safe. And Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Dilman ya. Oke, please lagi ya. Lagi ya.
First of all, I want to say thank you for Mr. Adi and everyone who has presented the material very well and interesting and also very much knowledge that we get. And I would like to say good luck for our middle exam. I hope you get get a good grades. Thank you.
Okay, so you must open visit the Edmodo. So the question for the midterm is there, yeah? Okay. Yeah, you must visit Edmodo very often. So I will put the question in Edmodo. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I will see you at on OB, but in on at RM. So it is the last meeting. Okay. Thank you very much for your coming here, and see you later.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. See you next time.
The toughest there is.
Thank you, sir.
In the room.